Good morning and welcome to Will of Southlake Online. My name is Scott. I'm one of the pastors here and I am so honored to be able to join you in your home this morning as we all are gathering in separate places to sit around and worship and learn. You know, I was reflecting this week of two times a storm happened. One time a storm happened and Jesus was in the boat with the disciples, and when he woke up, he calmed the storm. We also see another time that a storm is taking place. And Jesus is not in the boat with the disciples. Instead, they actually see him out there walking on top of the water. You know, however it is that you view the scenario and the reality of our world right now, the truth is that we serve a God who is powerful, we serve a God who is mighty, and we serve a God who deserves to be praised even in the midst of the storm. So, as we worship this morning, I'm going to encourage you fully engage, stand up, raise your hands, sing it out. When we pray, would you join us and pray together as one church, wherever it is that we are? And then when we get to our time of learning, get out a pen, get out a piece of paper, take notes, because we really want to just go in and lean into what God has for us in this season. We don't want to miss a thing because we know he is up to something. So now we're going to join him in a time of worship.
Well, good morning, Willow Southlake. It's so good to be with you in your homes this morning. Thank you for joining us. We just want to invite you to sing out as we worship. Sing this out.
Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow.
Gonna, oh no, you don't let us down. You're never gonna. walking around these walls. I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Oh, your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my
foundation that we can always rely on. We put all of our hope and our trust in you, God. You are with us in this season. Let's sing out to his holy name.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong. rest in His righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. We stand before Christ alone. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Yes, He is. You are Lord.
Christ alone, cornerstone, weak and strong in the Savior's love. And through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. You are
You are good. You are Lord. You meet us here right where we are. And we thank You for that. We thank You for Your presence, even in the craziest of circumstances, God, that You always are here meeting with us, reminding us of who we are in You, God. You are so, so good. We thank You for being here in our presence this morning. Would You bless the rest of this morning? We pray all of these things in Your name. Amen.
Hey, church family, it's good to worship with you this morning. And I know many of you are spending a lot of time indoors, but I hope that you're getting outside a little bit. So before we continue in our service, turn to someone who's sitting with you or comment in the chat and let us know what's your favorite outdoor activity right now. And then we'll continue in the service. Now, church, it can feel like everything is canceled in this season. But let me tell you, resurrection isn't canceled, Easter isn't canceled, and next weekend we are going to celebrate Good Friday and Easter together. We have two services on Friday at 5 and 7 p.m., and then we have two services on Easter Sunday at 9 and 11 a.m. So please get those on your calendar, join us for those services, and invite your family and friends. We'll be posting that information on social media. You can share it that way, or you can go to our website, wsl@home.org, and you can find all of the information about our services there, and you can just share that website with your family and friends. And so we're really excited about that. And we're excited because our Promised Land kids have a special opportunity to be a part of our Easter services this year. And so parents, if you have kids that are in fifth grade or under, they have a chance to participate. What I'd ask is that you go to our website, wslathome.org/kids, and you can find out all the information on how to be a part of this. Now, I don't want to give too much away, but it does involve recording some things and getting them submitted by midnight tonight. So it's going to be a great afternoon activity for your family, so make sure you check that out. Now, in this season, a lot of you have asked, how can we serve our congregation? How can we help our community? And we've shared with you some opportunities to do that. And I am so grateful because you have really stepped up and you've showed up to all of these serving opportunities. On Friday, we had a blood drive with 50 open spots, and all 50 of those spots were filled. And I just want to thank you for showing up to donate blood in a time where there is a critical blood shortage. Many of you dropped off groceries to restock our local food pantry, and many of you provided Easter baskets. Those Easter baskets are going to go to kids who are not just missing school right now, but they've been displaced from their homes because of domestic violence. And these Easter baskets are gonna go to bring a little bit of joy to a child on Easter. So I'm just so grateful for you, church. Thank you for the ways that you're showing up. Keep checking the website as we have more opportunities to serve and bless our community. You'll find them there. Now, speaking of meeting the needs of our community, we know that in this time, the needs around our congregation and in our neighborhoods is just going to increase. There's going to be more needs, more people struggling financially, more people in need of resources and help. And in this season, as a church, we as a staff are committed to reducing our expenses as much as possible. But here's what I would ask. If you have the means to be generous in this season, if you have the means to be able to be generous to the church, what we will do is we will minimize our expenses, and that will then give us margin that we can use to help our community, to bless the people that are going to be in need in this season. And so if you need to find out more information on how to give, you can go to willowsouthlake.org/give, or you can just go to that website we've been using for this church at home season. It's WSLathome.org, and you can find out information on how to give there. But our heart in this is to really come alongside people that we know are going to be struggling in the months ahead. And so please consider giving today to help meet some of those needs. Now, today, we're going to hear from a pastor that's very familiar to us. We've heard from him several times in the past. It's Pastor Albert Tate from Fellowship Monrovia Church in California. So now, let's go ahead and join in with Albert Tate.
Hey, Willow family. I am so excited. Listen, I've been coming to Chicago all this time, and now I get to bring you here to Southern California. Welcome to my home. I finally got y'all over to hang out. Listen, I miss seeing you. I miss seeing the faces. And I am excited, but also sobered by our national realities. So I am so glad that I get to share God's word with you today. And a little sad that I don't get to be there with you guys in person, but also really excited to be in y'all's house. I ain't been in here before. This is nice. Y'all got a nice house. This look good in here, y'all. What a season we're in. A season when the word of God means so much and we're so dependent upon the word of God. I'm so thankful to the Willow team and all the hard work that they're doing. And I'm just excited to be back. So glad to be in your homes. Grab your Bibles. Mark chapter 8. We're continuing in the Mark series. Mark chapter 8. We're going to look at Mark chapter 8, verse 27. Verse 27, and we're going to go all the way down to verse 37, all the way down to verse 37. Matthew chapter 8, let's hear God's word. Jesus and his disciples went on to the village around Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Peter answered, "You are the Messiah." Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? What can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." Let's pray. God, would you move by your Spirit as we, as I've been saying, as we are scattered together, as we're sitting in our homes, some of us riding in our car, some of us on the treadmill, as we're watching, some of us with families, as some of us are in our PJs watching it alone. Father, whatever we find ourselves, Father, would you speak, O Lord? Your children have scattered together to listen. Tune our ears to your voice so that we might hear you ever so clearly. Father, would you turn our hearts toward you so that we might experience the fullness of all that you have for us. God, is to that end that I ask that you stand in my body, think through my mind, speak through my vocal cords, those things you would have us say, know, and do. May the words of my mouth, meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, you are my strength. You are my redeemer. Get glory in this place. There's a story of a son who calls his mom, and he's discouraged, and he just can't find his way to get up out of the bed and go to church on Sunday. He couldn't find his way to go. And his mother tried to encourage. She said, "Son, you gotta go to church. You gotta go to church." He says, I don't wanna go. She says, "Son, you gotta go. It's gonna bless you. It's gonna be good for you to be there. You just gotta go." He says, "Mama, I don't wanna go." Finally, after going back and forth, she finally concludes. She says, "Well, listen, if for no other reason, since you the pastor, you need to go to church this Sunday." I guess he didn't want to go. He was tired and weary. And his mother had to have with him what I like to call a sobering conversation. A sobering conversation where you just get hit with the raw reality of why you need to go. I think that's what Jesus is having with his disciples, is a sobering conversation. It's a sobering conversation. And to be honest, this passage, it hits us with the wrong, strong reality of why we have to go and how we have to go. Jesus is giving us an invitation to follow him, and many of us are followers of Jesus Christ. He says, this is what it means to follow me. He has a very sobering conversation with his disciples. And I think Jesus wants to have a very sobering conversation with you and I today. It starts with, I think there's a bunch of emotion in the passage. Jesus is starting to tell of his death. His ministry has begun. It's been 33 years. He's starting to tell, get ready. I'm going to the cross. And I'm gonna die. And he starts to get comfortable. And as he gets to the cross, I'd imagine in his humanity, it's emotional for him. So you see him in this passage where he says, okay, they're sitting down and he says, "All right, y'all, let's talk. Who do men say I am? Who do men say I am? What's the word on the street? What are they saying about me?" Because he knows that who he is has a direct result of what's about to happen to him. So he wants to know, who do people think I am? And then almost like friends, he says, okay, but now who do you say I am? Because we've been walking together. You're my followers. We've been together. We've shared these moments together. Who do you say I am? And that's when Peter, represent, first one. Ooh, me. He's that guy in the classroom. Ooh, call on me. Peter says, thou art the Christ. You are the Messiah. And Jesus gives him one of the greatest compliments he could have ever given him. He says, flesh and blood did not reveal this to you. The Spirit speaking through you, Peter. The Spirit, come on now. And Peter like, yeah, I did that. And then Jesus has a moment with him. He says, yeah, guys, I'm the Christ. I'm the Messiah. And this is what that means. They're going to arrest me. They're going to bring accusations against me. And when we get there, when we get to Jerusalem, they're going to kill me. They're going to crucify me. But in 3 days, I'll rise again. And there'll be a new world order. I'm establishing something that you can't even see now. And I'm going to do a new thing. He shares this revelation with them that's profound and powerful. And watch what happens. Peter comes, taps him on the shoulder, like, yo, Jesus, thanks for sharing that. Could you come here for a second? Can I talk to you a little bit real quick? And the Bible says Peter rebukes Jesus. Now, Jesus, that ain't gonna happen, okay? I'm your boy. I'ma shut it down. Ain't nobody gonna be killing nobody. I'm shutting it down. Like, Peter comes over and rebukes Jesus. Go, like, who rebukes Jesus? He comes up, hey, Jesus, I rebuke you. I gotta rebuke you. I'm your boy, but I gotta rebuke you. What? And then Jesus looks at him. Watch this. Who he just gave the greatest compliment to and says, flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you. The Spirit of the Lord revealed this to you. He looks at the same dude and says, get behind me, Satan. Get behind me. How do you go from being filled with the Spirit to now being called Satan in a matter of 10 minutes? Well, that's when Jesus says, sit down, all of you, come here. Let's have a sobering conversation. Let me help you understand what's really going on here. Clearly, you don't get the full picture of what I'm doing. Let me provide for you the reality of what's happening in the earth right now. And he goes on and he begins to paint a picture of what discipleship really is. He paints a picture of what it means to follow Jesus Christ. And it's a hard picture to watch. It's a hard picture to see. But it brings about a sobriety because he rebukes Peter because he says, you are seeing this story centered on your humanity and not centered on the kingdom work that God has called me to do. And if you try to process the work of Jesus through your humanity, you gonna miss Jesus. Because our humanity wants the story of Jesus Christ to be played in our life, played out in our life, as comfortable as possible. So when he started talking about some crucifixion and death, oh no, that's not the story we want. Peter's like, no, there's a very G-rated version of this that we can do. And Jesus says, I rebuke you, Satan. I didn't come for a G-rated version because a G-rated version won't get us to the power of the resurrection that our Heavenly Father has required. So he sits down and he gives a clear picture of what discipleship really is. And I think it's important for us to come back to these passages and be reminded, to walk in a sense of sobriety and be reminded that here it is, number one, it's just not about you. It's just not about you. We're in a season where there are a lot of reasons to complain. There are a lot of reasons to experience frustration. There are a lot of reasons. You can easily make this season about you. I can easily make this season about me. The disciples, Peter was making a moment about him and his comfort. And Jesus says, listen, if you live your life trying to save your life, you will lose your life. But if you lose your life for my sake, you will find your life. Ah, he's saying, listen, don't spend your days asking the question, how comfortable can I be? Don't spend your days asking the question, trying to figure out how much can I save? How much of my life can I save? How much can I not change and still be okay? How much sacrifice is Jesus really requiring? He says, if you live your life, you will lose your life. You will never experience the fullness of what I have for you. But if you give your life away for my glory, if you lose your life for my sake, then you'll find it. It's this dynamic. It's kind of like this. I could tell y'all ain't getting it. Let me try to help you. You ever go on a cruise ship? A cruise ship, I mean, ain't nobody going on them now, but back when we could go on cruise ships, I'm telling you, is one of the best things in the world. I'm telling you, they have all-night buffets. All-night buffets. Now, I know you're thinking, why in the world would you need a buffet at 2:00 in the morning? And that's what I thought. And when I went down there at 2:00 in the morning, I was like, why in the world? Who wants to be at a buffet at 2:00 in the morning? Well, turns out everybody on the ship want to be at the buffet at 2:00 in the morning because it was packed. Everybody was up in there. Everybody was up in there eating watermelon, pineapple, and steaks all at the same time. Who even eats like this in the normal world? Everything on a ship is catered to your pleasure, to your comfort, to your desire. Everything is catered to what you want. They live for the pleasure of its passengers. They live for the pleasure of their passengers. A lot of times we think following Jesus is like being on a cruise ship. You think the church is designed to live for the pleasure of its passengers. You think that's what the kingdom is all about. No, the kingdom of God is not like a cruise ship. It's a lot more like a battleship. Never forget a pastor using this illustration, and he said, a battleship ain't like no cruise ship. Oh no, ain't no pool on the Lido deck of a battleship. They got big guns, they got the dining experience. You know what they call the dining place? They call it the mess hall. That's how much they got. They ain't care nothing about, because it's not designed for the comfort and the pleasure of its passengers. A battleship is designed to fulfill the mission of the banner that it flies. A battleship is designed to fulfill the mission of the banner that it flies. As followers of Jesus Christ, he's trying to help you understand, listen, if you come in here, if you're trying to follow me and trying to stay on the Lido deck, you're going to miss me. But if you would recognize that your life is not your own and surrender it over to the mission of the kingdom of God, then you'll find me. Find me. Or it's kind of like being married. Being married. If you're the as a husband being married to my wife, I realize when I'm in an argument with her, if I'm trying to be right, I'm going to be wrong. But if I can go on and be wrong, then I'll be right. Now, some of y'all are like, Albert, it wasn't making sense until you said that. Now, when you said that, that's it. That changed my marriage right there. Jesus is just saying, don't follow me trying to still preserve yourself. Because there's a cross that we all have to bear. And on that cross, we have to sacrifice ourselves. Where do you need to sacrifice? Where are you trying to save your life where you actually need to lose it? Where are you trying to hold on where you really should let go? Where are you trying to preserve when you really should surrender? He says, if you're going to follow me, here's a sobering reality. It's not about you. And if you follow me trying to make it about you, you're going to miss me. That's what he's saying. Not only that, but he goes on and he says, what profit the man to gain the whole world and lose your soul? So if you go after you and you do it, he says, what profit a man to gain the whole world and lose your soul? The most dangerous thing about that statement is that you can gain the whole world and still lose your soul. You can win and still lose. You can get it right, but still get it wrong. It's so sobering to me because I think you can be successful. You could get everything that this world has to offer. You could win in every way. You could be a great business person, win in society, be great. You could win and be a person worthy of celebration in this world and stand before God and he say, I never knew you. The world loved you, but you never loved me. You can get it all right and still get it wrong. You can gain the world and still lose your soul. I remember back in my seminary days, I was not, I was a different kind of student, if you will. You got some students that, they go to class, they read the syllabus, they do the assignments, you know what I mean? You got those kind, that type. But then you got people like me who honestly, I like to live a little bit more spontaneously in the spirit of the living God. I like to let God kind of lead me. So he'll lead me to my papers. He'll lead me to the reading. I just like to be free in the spirit. Come on, anybody else out there like me like to be free in the spirit? Well, here's the problem with that. You want to be free in the spirit, you got to be prepared. There's some awkward moments. It lends itself to some awkward moments. There are times when I've walked in class and seeing other people, they got papers on their desk. And I'd be like, we got a paper due today? I'll be back, because I didn't know, right? So I'll never forget being in Dr. Glenn Stassen's class at Fuller Seminary, Kingdom Ethics, and I had a paper due. I had a paper due, and I just happened to be sitting, and my syllabus just fell open. My syllabus just fell open, and I happened to see I got a paper due next week. And I know about it early. Praise the Lord. The Spirit has led me here. So I remember doing my paper and I turned it in early, which, parenthetically, early for me is on time. I turned it in on time early. And I was arrogant. I just knew I killed it. I knew I just killed this paper. So I turned it in arrogantly. I went to my professor's desk. I threw it on his desk. I said, you ain't even got to grade that, Jack. It's an A waiting to happen. And I walked out the room. I was just arrogant. So they're passing the papers out. And we're getting our papers back. And I'm looking at it. And, I'm not even looking at my paper. I'm just looking around at everybody else thinking, man, if he grading this on the curve, I put the curve through the roof, Jack. I did that. And finally, I look at my paper, and he got it on there, and it says, great content on the front page. And I'm thinking to myself, I know, you ain't got to tell me. I know it's great content. I wrote it. I know it's good. And then we get to the back, and then on the last page, it says, big red letters, F, wrong assignment. Great content, wrong assignment. One day we'll stand before God. And the greatest fear is that he'd say, great content, but wrong assignment. You gained the world, but you lost your soul. Are you pursuing God? Are you pursuing the world? Are you coming after the kingdom? Or have you been captivated with the empire? I'm telling you, you can win in this world and not hit the right assignment and lose in the kingdom. He says, it's not about you. Don't spend your life trying to save your life. Surrender it to me and you will find this new life. You'll find this new life. But if you get so captivated with the world, you will win in the world and lose in the kingdom. Third and finally, he says, don't be ashamed of me. he's saying that he's about to be crucified, and it is probably the one of the most shameful ways to be put to death. But he says, don't be ashamed of me. Stand in who I am. Stand in the truth of this gospel. Don't be ashamed. I almost think he's prophetically looking at Peter saying, a few days from now, you're going to deny me and you're going to be ashamed of me. But I almost want to give you a word ahead of time to prepare you for the failure that's about to come. He gives him a word of preparation before the failure. Because we know in a couple of verses, Peter's going to deny Christ three times. He's going to be ashamed of him. But that's not where Peter's story ends. Peter will be ashamed in this moment, but his redemption will take him from being ashamed to now being one of the most courageous voices of the gospel in all of written history. I guess I want to encourage those that might have had seasons where they didn't stand up like they should. Or even in this season that we're in now, you're discouraged and you're walking in fear and not faith. And maybe you are ashamed of what you believe because you're seeing bad things happening. Or you're ashamed of what you believe because your belief is going to require more of a sacrifice and more discomfort than you thought. That's what Peter did. Peter was ashamed, number one, because of the fear of what other people thought and the trial that would come. And then Peter just had a cleaner version. He had a rated G version, a version that didn't require Jesus Christ dying on the cross. He says, don't be ashamed of my version. Don't be ashamed of the story that I'm writing. So I want to encourage you. Where are there areas in your life where it's been marked by timidity, a lack of courage with your faith? We live in a time where we need bold faith. We need bold faith. Now's not the time to be ashamed. Now's the time to trust and believe that your God is good, your God is great, your God has gone before you, he's made a way for you. And Peter, even if you fail, I got you on the other side. Your story will not end in shame. Your story will end in victory. Let me encourage you. Your story will not end in shame. Your story will end in victory. So I pray that you will be sobered by the reality to know that this season is about you losing your life, not you saving it. And it's a challenge to don't go after the things of this world, go after the things of the kingdom, so that you might experience the life, the missional battleship life that he's called you to live. And we don't walk in shame. We're not ashamed of our Father. We're not ashamed of the gospel. We trust him because God's going to use us, and he's going to use us for his glory. Amen. Father, I thank you so much for everyone watching. Thank you for those families that are there. Father, I thank you so much that you are faithful. You are a good God. So, Father, we won't spend these days in quarantine and safe housing and trying to save our lives, Father. We will surrender our life to you, and we will look up to heaven and we say, Lord, we live daily under the posture that says, not my will, but thy will be done. We won't spend these days in this season trying to gain the things of the world while losing the things of our soul. So, Father, we're not looking to the world to win. We're looking to the King of Kings to win. And finally, we walk in courage and not timidity. We are not ashamed of who you are. And Father, we're so thankful that in the places, in the seasons, in the moments where our journey with you has been marked with shame, like Peter, you're redeeming all things. Thank you, Father. Do it for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Willow, so good to be back. God bless you. Have a great week.
Thank you for joining us today. It has been a pleasure to worship, to pray, and to learn with you. Now, I want to remind you that we have a whole bunch of content and ways for you to stay connected and to serve our community right on our website, wslathome.org. Feel free to engage in the forums down at the bottom of the homepage, or go in and see what's happening in our preschool ministry or our fourth and fifth grade ministry or any of the things that's happening with our students. God is still up to some amazing things, and we look forward to seeing you in those places. Thanks, everybody. Have a great week.